Hey guys, and welcome to another fun and easy lecture on CANBUS. So what is CANBUS? It stands for Control Area Network. Now CANBUS was developed in the mid-1980s. It was developed mainly for the automotive industry. And this is because it's a well-proven technology. It's reliable and robust. It allows for multi-master configuration, and it's quite inexpensive. No need to pay those expensive royalty fees like I2C. CANBUS currently comes in two types, which is known as CAN 2.0A, and this allows for 11-bit message identifiers. More on this later in this lecture. There's also CAN 2.0B. This is an improvement from A by allowing 29-bit message identifiers. CAN A is known as standard CAN, and CAN 2.0B is known as extended CAN. There are other differences between A and B, but we'll not discuss it in this lecture. There's also a third CAN, which is known as CAN FD, which stands for Flexible Data Rate. So it's quite similar to CAN 2.0, but it's capable of carrying a higher data rate or higher data payload. It was developed by Bosch in 2011 and released in 2012. So this specification basically uses a different frame format that allows for a different data length, as well as optionally switching to a faster bitrate after the arbitration is decided. CAN FD is compatible with existing CAN 2.0 networks, and this is so that new CAN FD devices can coexist with the same network of existing CAN devices. There's also three speeds to CAN. So CAN 2.0A is capable of 125 kilobits per second. This is known as low speed. At this speed, your devices can be up to 500 meters apart. Now, if you want to go slightly higher than that with CAN 2.0B, you can go up to around 1 megabit per second. This is known as high speed, and devices can be separated up to 40 meters. Now, if you go higher than that using CAN FD, you can go up to 15 megabits per second, and this is using flexible data rate. Unfortunately, the higher you go, the lower distance you can have between the devices. This is mainly because of the error that occurs at higher data rates. Let's take a look at the applications of CANBUS. Now, as I mentioned before, that CANBUS is used mainly in the automotive industry. It's also used in the marine industry, industrial machinery, in the military, for elevators, as well as medical devices. This is how CANBUS is wired up. So you have your devices, and then these devices need to be terminated using 120 ohm termination resistors. And over here we have CAN low and CAN high. Let's talk more about the signals. So CAN high and CAN low are differential signals. CAN high goes up to 3.5 volts, whereas CAN low goes below 1.5 volts, all the way down to zero. The nominal voltage is around 2.5 volts. So this area over here is known as the dominant zero. Over here we have a recessive one, as well as on this side. Let's take a look at the full protocol and how it works and how to send your messages. So this is the complete CAN frame. It consists of the start frame, the arbitration field, control, data CRC field, acknowledge field, as well as the end of frame. So if we start over here with the start of frame. So this denotes the start of frame transmission and indicates the beginning of message. It starts with a dominant logic 0 bit. Next, we have our arbitration field. This identifies the messages and indicates the message priority. Now say both engine and light indicator has failed. Now, because we're broadcasting these messages, we basically want our engine to have the higher priority. Because if your engine has failed, something bad will go wrong. If your light fails, you can still drive your car. So arbitration basically indicates which device has the higher priority. So in this case, your engine will have the higher priority over the light. As you can see, we have 11 bits. Now for extended CAN, as we spoke about, which is CAN 2.0B, that uses a 29-bit arbitration ID. Next, we got our request remote. This serves to differentiate a remote frame from a data frame. So a dominant logic 0, RTR bit, indicates a data frame, whereas a recessive logic 1, RTR bit, indicates a remote frame. We also have an ID extension bit, as well as a reserve bit that can be used for future use. Moving on, we have the number of bytes of data. So this indicates how much data is stored inside here. You can think of it as a packet length. This number can be anywhere between 0 and 8 bytes for CAN 2.0A. For CAN 2.0B or FD, this will be larger. So this is the data to be transmitted, and the length in bytes is indicated in the DLC field over here. CAN FD can have up to 64 bytes, whereas CAN 2.0 can have up to 8 bytes. This is also known as the payload. Over here we have our 15-bit cyclic redundancy check code, as well as a recessive delimiter bit. Our CRC field is used for error detection. So the CRC field is used for error detection. This helps the CAN bus to be much more robust and reliable. And then we have our acknowledge bits. So any CAN controller that correctly receives the messages sends an acknowledge bit at the end of the message. The transmitting node checks for the presence of the acknowledge bit on the bus and reattempts transmission if no acknowledge is detected. And then finally we have our ender frame, which must all be recessive ones or logic ones. Okay, that is it for this lecture. Thank you for watching. Please don't forget to like, subscribe and share, and I'll see you in the next video. If you have any comments and if you enjoyed this video, please let me know in the comments down below. Also, if you want to learn about any other protocols, please let me know in the comments also, and I'll be sure to make a video on that. Okay, thank you for watching and see you in the next video.